Shalom, y'all. About to be Shabbat Shalom. It's about 5:45, something like that. Friday. We about to go into the Lord's weekly feast, weekly Sabbath day, which we all have been accustomed to keeping since we came into the true knowledge of our good God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So I'm going to try to make this real fast, even on a subject so serious, because it is serious. But I'm going to make it fast because my battery get low, and then when it get low, I start skipping and blah, blah, blah. And I know a train going to come by too, watch y'all, because I got all the windows down, up. So watch a train try to come through. So I'm going to try to get through this fast, right? So y'all bear with me, and I'm going to try to get back to the comments. Hey, Sister Cynthia. I'm gonna try to peace, sister. Peace. Who is that, Sister Blanche Dix? Hey, peace, beloved. So I'm gonna try to get through this kind of quick, right? So yeah, we got the Day of Atonement coming up at sundown tonight. Also, the weekly Sabbath. So this is what we call a double Sabbaru. What up, Chuck? Peace, bro. So let me say this first off, too, y'all. Israel off the chain. I made a post earlier in my group, Walls of Jericho, Biblical Historical Studies, so that's where I do my ministry work at. I didn't put it on my wall intentionally, because I didn't want everybody calling up to the elder saying, Mikael said, you can't brush your teeth during fasting or during the atonement. Look, man. I knew y'all was going to do this. I know somebody that did it already. So I know I'm probably going to get cut over the Sabbath lesson tomorrow. Because, look, I specifically put in my group, this is why I don't brush my teeth during the atonement. This is why you notice it's a lot of usually elder people who, you know, because when it's time to give you that little greeting kiss, you know, that kiss with holy kisses, you notice they kind of just give you the tap on the shoulder because a lot of them got the dragon breath because they ain't putting nothing in their mouth, right? So I did say it was in the law of Leviticus chapter 23 that you can't brush your teeth during the atonement. So don't nobody go back and say that, and I hope don't nobody said that. I just read what was written in the book. So this is how, when the question was posed to me, how do I fast? When I fast, I do like it say, search the scriptures, right? And so, now I told you they was gonna do this. As soon as we start doing the show, I told you a train was gonna come. I got the windows up because it feel good. So can y'all hear me though? Y'all can still hear me, so cool. Shalom, Ross. So look, right? So, when people ask me how do I fast, I told them this how I fast because we are supposed to search the scriptures, right? And it's evidence of us doing this because when you want to know how our ancestors did it because they had a little better understanding than we did, you go search the scriptures, right? And so I went, and this is what I posted in my group, like I said before, y'all try to get me jumped on tomorrow, but this is what I read. So I went to how in the world did I go to now? I'm in Jonah chapter 3, right? So Jonah chapter 3, this is what was told to the people of Nineveh when the Lord was about, Shalom, Derek, when the Most High was about to destroy Nineveh, right? Jonah chapter 3. Now, this is why I fast the way I fast and others with the understanding that I get. This ain't what it said word for word in Atonement in Leviticus chapter 23, which we're going to read. But this is what I call my safe way of fasting because I ain't trying to cheat. You know, it's been a lot of laziness starting to pop up in Israel lately. Like, they trying to find an easy way out for everything. I mean, it's just the 24 hours. You know what I'm saying? Like, I just keep my mouth shut for 24 hours. Like, you know, Ain't nothing going in here for 24 hours. I ain't gonna die. So look, right? Here it goes. Jonah chapter 3. And this is what I posted. It says, verse 5. So the people of Nineveh believed God and proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them even unto the least of them. So they accepted the warning from Jonah after he didn't want to give one. Remember, he was running from God and he had the big fish swallowing. So he was gonna destroy Nineveh. So they said, okay, we gonna do this fast because we scared. We don't want to be destroyed. We believe you, man. So look, verse 7. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published through Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. That's quite clear. Let them not feed nor drink water. So we know when we hear don't feed, that means don't eat, and don't drink water. We know that's how you fast. So that could be applied to Leviticus chapter 23 on the Day of Atonement. Now that first part, this is the only time I've seen it say, and taste anything. And that's why I said that it don't say that in Leviticus 23. So it don't say that in the law. It don't say that in the atonement. But with my understanding on when I fast, y'all, I'm not telling y'all to do this, but when I fast, I follow this because I understand if I put a sucker in my mouth or anything of that nature that I'm sucking on, that your mouth is one of the fastest absorber of nutrients, liquids, or toxins into your body. So if I'm afflicting my soul, I don't want nothing going into my body, period. And that includes toothpaste with me. I don't want to taste anything. See what I'm saying? So that's my level of understanding or my understanding of it. And that's why when I fast, I don't put nothing in my mouth. I ain't, you know, no suckers, peppermints, bubble gum, none of that. You know what I'm saying? Because if it's only just food and water, then, you know, you could be chewing gum all day or whatever. I know it's people that try to do petty stuff like that. I'm not saying that's how y'all are, but that's just me. You know, I'm going to afflict my soul. I mean, did y'all see how Jesus was afflicted? He got a double real affliction for us. So that little day ain't like nothing. You know what I'm saying? We ain't getting beat, bricked, spit on, none of that. So it ain't no big thing to me. So I just want to clear that up and put that out there for y'all get me jumped on by the elders thinking I'm making it grievous because I said that I'd use Jonah when it comes to fasting. That's me, y'all. I ain't gonna say that no more. So that's clear. Because you know Israel. Mikael said, dang, I read it. No, Jonah said. Like, for example, when y'all see how Israelites read the scriptures, right? We have a teacher making the word clear, expounding on it, right? And then we have a reader, which I don't have today, which I haven't had in a while. But I'm going to get that back straightened out, too. And they have a reader, right? And if you ever look, they got people standing on their right. They got people standing on their left. Even the ones that y'all call super brews, they even do the same thing. They even, you know, they do it a little bit different. But they do have the reader, and they got the people on this side and that side. Do y'all know why they do that? Because you search the scriptures. It don't say in the law that you necessarily have to read that way from anywhere that I'm saying. I could be corrected. But I know when you go to Nehemiah, the book of Nehemiah, I believe in the 8th chapter, 8th and 9th chapter, 7th, try the 7th, 8th, 9th chapter. It tell you when Ezra and them came, they was establishing the law and stuff back in the land, that they stood up to read and they had the other teachers and stuff to the right and to the left. You know, reading the book, breaking it down. So this is why one reason that Israelites do that like that, because they search the scripture. So that's all I did. I searched the scripture, say, whoa, how did they fast when they was about to be destroyed? This place about to be destroyed. So this is how I fast. I got the same fear and trembling that they had in Nineveh. And when you read Philippians chapter 2:12-14, it say, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. So, and be blameless. So y'all don't want to be at the end and be like, oh man, I ain't know you couldn't do it like that, right? So that's how I look at it. That's just me, y'all. That's just me. So I'm making this video because some brothers from another camp, which I won't name, y'all might have seen it on Facebook, was saying that you don't have to keep the atonement. And these some Hebrew Israelites. That's the first time I ever heard Hebrew Israelites say something like that. Well, no, I know some Old Testament brothers who say you don't got to keep nothing because you ain't in the land no more. So they basically worse than modern day commercial Sunday Christians. I mean, you know, they don't got no laws. Like, they just want to say Yah all the time. Like, Yah, and just commit abominations all day long. So they're the most dangerous Hebrews ever. But this camp right here, it was brought to my attention. The brother sent me a lesson they did either today or yesterday and to my inbox, and they were saying, you don't have to keep the atonement based on this. We about to read this, and then I'm going to show y'all where that is a gross and dangerous misunderstanding of the text. And if you know who it is, it's always Paul. So we see we got Israelites that's just like the Sunday Christians. They want to run to Paul to try to get you from under something that the Father and Christ, Jesus, got established already. And that's like crazy. So, but you know, it was said by the brother who sent it to me that this particular camp, he's dealt with them, and they actually pretty on point in his opinion. He said they just off on this. So that's why I'm not going to name the camp and, like, you know, attack them or nothing. But I hope that they see this. So I hope y'all share this. And I hope that those brothers take this correction, because that's quite dangerous to be telling a nation of sinners to not keep the Day of Atonement when it's clearly written in the law in Leviticus chapter 23 as one of the seven annual feasts and high Sabbaths and all of that that we supposed to keep every year. So, you know, you had stuff outside of that the Lord used to let us keep, like Feast of Dedication and things of that nature. You know what I'm saying? But them wasn't required. That was something he let us do because we wasn't breaking no law. You know what I'm saying? I'm like what you call Israel's secular holidays. You know what I mean? And it wasn't pagan. But here, he told us we about to keep the Day of Atonement. And the crazy thing about it, Jesus Christ represents the atonement. He don't do away with the atonement. He's connected to it. So this is what they read. This is what they sent. This is Romans chapter 5, right? And this is what they read, verse 11. It say, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. So they took that to say, see, you ain't got to keep the atonement no more because Jesus Christ is our atonement. Well, I agree that Jesus Christ is our atonement. But again, with Paul's letters, what did Paul mean by Jesus is our atonement? So we're going to do this real easy, y'all. We're going to do this real, real easy. So let's look at what, matter of fact, before I go into why he's our atonement, let's look at something that Jesus himself said, the master teacher, right? Let's see what he said. Because see, woo, boy, man, they going to, I promise you, I'm glad the dead know nothing, like Ecclesiastes said, because I know Paul would be terrified in his grave, Joe, the stuff people would attribute him to. Like, they basically say he just came and just changed everything. But that's why Peter told us, that was 2 Peter, he told us, man, look, if you unlearned in the law and stuff, do not run to Paul's writing. He told you that. He basically told you be careful. He said Paul had wisdom, but the way he wrote, you would destroy yourself. Literally, it'll lead to your destruction because you would cherry pick Paul's writing and get yourself in trouble. So let's see what Jesus said. So let's look at Matthew chapter 5, right? And I'm gonna try to make this fast. Go to verse 17. It say, think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. So we're going to go look and see if the Day of Atonement is a jot or a tittle, right? Verse 19, whosoever therefore shall break one of the least of these commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whosoever shall do and teach them, the same shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. So I want to be called great, because those that's called least is going to be in the lake of fire. Point blank, period. Because you can go other scriptures and it tell you that we going to walk by and be able to see them burning. If that ain't least, I don't know what is. So don't let nobody send you off with that. So you see it said he did not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill. We're going to point out which law that is, which all of y'all know by now. And it connects to why Paul said he is our atonement, right? We're going to do this real simple. So we're going to go to Hebrews chapter 7. This is real clear, y'all. Hebrews chapter 7. I read this a couple of weeks ago when they tried to use Paul again. I think it was Colossians 5 or something, when he said the law and the ordinances was done away with. And I went to this to show you what cardinal law and ordinances he was talking about. So I'm going to go to Hebrews chapter 7. And let me see. Let's pick it up at... Should I pick it up at 3, 4? Because I don't want to read this whole thing. I'm going to go to 11 through 17. So we're going to start here. Let me start at verse 11. It say, if therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? So y'all understand that the priest tribe was the Levites, and the high priest came out of the son of Aaron, right? This who atoned for your sins. Literally. This who took your sins up there to the altar and all that for you to atone for your sins. So this is finna show you why Paul said what he said about Jesus being our atonement, in which he is. Verse 12, for the priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. Hold on, the priesthood been changed? Yeah, we don't have the Levites no more. And Jesus knew we wasn't going to have no more. He wept about it because all of us was going to get scattered. The temples was going to be torn down and all of that. Jesus ultimately always was set up to have to come and be the atonement. We was using bulls and goats, but we're going to let this explain to you why Jesus is the atonement. Verse 13, for he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. See, so whoever this atonement is, this blood is going to come from to atone for our sin. He's playing a role of the high priest on the altar, but it say his tribe wasn't mentioned. Who was mentioned? The Levites. So let's see what tribe this cat come out of. Verse 14, for it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah. Oh, so they go to change. Not the Levitical priesthood who sprinkled the blood, took it to the altar, but this blood that's going to be sacrificed, this atonement is going to come by way of the tribe of Judah. So let's see who this is. Of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning the priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest, who is made not after the law and carnal commandment, but after the power of endless life. This is talking about Jesus Christ. We know who this is. He can't die. So this lets you know that law and commandment that Paul said was done away with, and I believe it was Colossians 5 a couple weeks ago, somebody came up with that, is actually talking about this. It's talking about the ordinances and commandments that you needed when you went to the altar that the priest had to perform for you to get your atonement, which is what Paul just said in Romans chapter 5, verse 11, Jesus Christ is our atonement. So we definitely need to keep the Day of Atonement, and I'm going to show you why. So I'm going to keep reading, verse 17. For he testified, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. I'm going to skip down to verse 19. It say, for the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. Verse 21. For those priests were made without an oath, but this with the oath, by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Listen to this. Verse 22. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. Clear as day. Can't get around this. Jesus replaced the Levitical priesthood because he is our high priest right now, taking our sins when we pray to the Father in his name, because he died and became our atonement. So his blood represents the sprinkling of the blood that Moses used to do with the creatures on the book and on the Holy of Holies. We gonna actually see why that is so. So I might as well read this part too. I said I wasn't gonna do that, but it get too good near the bottom. So I might as well. I'm gonna skip to verse 20. Let me see. Oh, I'll read verse 25. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. Y'all see that clear? Moses was the intercessor back in that day. That's why it said prophet like unto Moses. Aaron had the priesthood set up, so everybody that came through that followed that protocol from that day forward, representing the intercessor. Whoever the high priest was represented the intercessor. So when we sin, we took the goats, lambs, and all of that stuff, right? Turtle doves or whatever. We took them to them, and he was the intercessor to God, to the Father for us. He was the intercessor. Y'all get it? So Jesus replaced that. Because every time one of them Levites died, another Levite had to come fill a spot. Because the only way you could get out of the priesthood is you died out. It wasn't no retiring like that Pope did in the Catholic Church. Was that a few years back? And that was weird because that never happened in the Catholic Church before, because they basically tried to hijack the Levitical priesthood. So that's why you see them popes be like 200 years old, you know, slobbing, can't hold their neck up, and they still be hanging on to their life because they can't retire. They got to die. See, all this thing go deep. But really, that's blasphemy against Jesus Christ, because he is our intercessor. So when Catholics talk all that about Jesus, 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 but the way that system's set up, they telling Jesus to go, you know, kick a shoe. So I'm going to keep reading. Let's say verse 26. For such a high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. Y'all get that? Because see, remember the high priest once a year, when he would go give up our sins or whatever, you know, he had to give his own up too, because he was a man. He committed sins. But this one, it say this dude, he said he holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. So he ain't never committed no sin. So let me read this last part. It say, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, talking about the ones back in the day, to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did once when he offered up himself. Y'all hear that? This is why Jesus is our atonement, brothers, because he offered up his own blood. He not going up there on the altar with the blood of animals to atone for our sins, no, you know, like the Levitical priesthood did. He offered up himself in that blood. Therefore, when we pray now to the Father in his name, he is making a petition to the Father like he's on an altar, but it's a heavenly altar. It's not the one made with hands. We about to read that right now. So let's skip right over to Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, stay on top. So y'all please share this so those brothers will stop sending people off and get some people in trouble talking about you ain't got to keep the Day of Atonement. Hebrews chapter 9, I'm going to pick it up in verse 1. This is what it say. that verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. Y'all hear? He's talking about the worldly temple that we had to go sacrifice with the altar, the holy holies, all in there. Watch this, y'all. For there was a tabernacle made the first, wherein was the candlestick and the table and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. So he telling you how this how the temple used to be made in Jerusalem, in the land. This is the worldly temple that men built. This was a replica of what's in heaven. You see what I'm saying? That's what Jesus is in the one in heaven not doing this for us. It say, and after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all, that represent what a father is in heaven. But this was the regular little man-made one that we used to keep in the land. So look, right, it say, and then he go in and describe it, you know, go in and describe it, but y'all can read that on your own. Let's get down to the meat part. Verse 6, it say, now when these things were thus ordained, the priests went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. Verse 7, but into the second went the high priest alone, once every year, not without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. See, y'all hear that? It's clear. So the high priest will go in the holiest of holies. He will offer up a sacrifice of blood for himself because he's a man and he sinned. He wasn't like Jesus Christ who committed no sin. And he offered up a sin for the nation of Israel, for the people. This is what the Day of Atonement still represents. So we still got the Day of Atonement. We still got the high priest under the order of Melchizedek. His name is Jesus Christ. And we still got the blood offering. But it's not from goats. That was carnal. It is from him when he died around 70 AD. I mean, well, before, yeah, 70, see, wait, see, temple got 70 AD, 69 AD, somewhere up in there. And they hung him on the cross. And he bled, and his side was pierced. That was the sacrifice right there. That was the sacrifice right there. And if you notice, he didn't even get sacrificed on a physical altar like we was doing with the animals. It was more of a like symbolic altar because he did it in front of the world superpower and in front of his own people. See, that's deep. That represented a whole lot. And that's why we still doing it. But I'm going to continue reading. So I'm going to skip down to verse 9 real quick. Let's check out verse 9. Let me see what it say. Which was a figure for the time being present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances. See, these are carnal ordinances that Paul was talking about over there that people trying to use when he say the laws and the ordinances was done away with. These the ones. He's talking about dealing all with sacrificing in the temple to prepare sacrifice. That's it. So look, verse 11. But Christ being come and high priest of good things to come. Wait, who? But Christ being come and high priest, you hear, of good things to come by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building. Boom, that blows all that out the water. So Jesus Christ is our high priest now. He's taking the slot from the high priest that came out of the loins of Aaron and Zadok now, which were Levites. Jesus Christ is their high priest now. They did it in a physical temple. He's doing it in a heavenly temple. This is quite clear. You can't get around it. Israel should know this, especially if they got a camp. Verse 12, neither by the blood of bulls and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. That's clear as day. Y'all see it? He's up there like the high priest used to come once a year. Jesus did it that one time when he died. He ain't finna keep dying for you. He ain't finna keep suffering for you. When you repent, he's gonna keep on being your intercessor and taking your sins to the Father. If you repent ignorantly, meaning you're not out here sinning on purpose, and thinking you're going to keep pulling the mercy card. So I might as well skip down and clear this up. Let's look at verse 22 real quick, y'all. It say, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood. And without shedding of blood is no remission. So y'all heard that. If it ain't no bloodshed, ain't no remission for your sins. You is caught in your sin and you're cut off and you're dead. Unless, like the Christians, so-called Christians say, if you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. But we know what that means. We really have to accept that he died, because he did it. He did it whether you accept it or not. But he died and he replaced the Levitical high priesthood. If not, y'all need to be trying to find y'all a temple somewhere to go sacrifice some pigeons and stuff, or y'all in trouble. Y'all in dead trouble. You stop trying to talk around that. Go on to Psalms, a couple books where it say obedience is better than sacrifice. Exactly. And if you're not obedient, you got to go find a sacrifice or brick showers, brick showers. So let me continue. We're going to get to this other little part because I want to make sure that this Romans chapter 5 is not beat up again. So we see in Matthew chapter 5, y'all, verse 17 through 19, Jesus said he come not to destroy the law, but, you know, to fulfill it. And then he turned around and said, one little jot or tittle ain't supposed to be moved, you know, until the end is over with. It ain't the end. And let's see if this is a jot and a tittle. Let's go to Leviticus chapter 23 and see how serious that was. Now, Paul just broke down the whole thing they used to have to do with the sacrifices. We all know that. So let's check out. Let's go and check out the law. Y'all know where this at. And I guess I'll just go straight to it. So he names off all the annual feast days that we supposed to keep. When y'all get a chance, go to Leviticus chapter 23, read that whole thing. Passover, you know, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, you know, the Day of Atonement, the First Fruits, the Tabernacles, the all of that, trumpets and all that type of stuff. But let's read what it says right here. So I'm going to pick it up in verse 24. It said, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, in the first day of the month, shall ye have a Sabbath, a memorial of blowing the trumpets and a holy convocation. We just did that. We just kept that. Praise God. And say verse 25, ye shall do no servile work therein, but ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. Let's continue. Verse 26, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, so he spoke unto him. He's giving him orders. This ain't no option. Also, on the 10th day of this seventh month, there shall be a day of atonement. It shall be a holy convocation unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls, that's fasting, and offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And ye shall do, no, and I can show y'all too, other forms, what, well, we'll get into that later. And ye shall do no work in the same day, for it is the day of atonement, to make an atonement for you before the Lord your God. For whatsoever soul it be that shall not be afflicted in the same day, he shall be cut off from among his people. This is serious. And y'all going out here teaching some people because you believe in Christ that you can't keep the day of atonement, y'all gonna get Israel in some serious trouble. And I see shalom, Brother Zion. And I see why sometimes us brothers who accept the whole Bible and we rotate with the New Testament, we get a bad rap. Because if you got people coming out here saying Jesus just did away with everything the Father has set up, that is dangerous. You just as bad as sitting in them Sunday churches. If you're talking about Leviticus 23 is done away with, then we might as well just, I don't even know what we over here playing for. We through. So let me continue reading. It saying, whatsoever soul it be that doeth any work in that same day, the same soul will I destroy from among his people. Ye shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statue forever. Hold up. Let me see that again. It shall be a statue ever throughout your generations in all your dwellings. Because you got Israelites running around here talking about, if we ain't in the land, we can't keep nothing. This say all your dwellings. Last time I checked, I'm not dwelling in Jerusalem right now, but I see all your dwellings is quite clear. Whether you in Chicago, Detroit, or Wichita, you supposed to be keeping these. I ain't trying to hit it. So, well, the Lord ain't trying to hit it. Verse 31. Ye shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statue forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. All, there you go again. It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month at even, from even unto even, shall ye celebrate your Sabbath. And that's another thing I want to point out too. If y'all peeped in verse 27, right? When it gets to the day, this cut another false doctrine out there. That you actually get Israelites running around saying that the day really starts in daylight. Like they done went right back to sun worship, right? Did y'all peep what it said in verse 27? It say also on the 10th day of the 7th month, there shall be a day of atonement. He said on the 10th day. Now watch what he turn around and say. And it shall be a holy convocation unto you, and ye shall afflict your souls and offer offering made by fire unto the Lord. And ye shall do no work in that same day, for it is the day of the atonement and making atonement for you before the Lord. Now, it keeps saying in the same day. Now, you heard it say the 10th day. But look what it say in verse 32. It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest, and ye shall afflict your souls in the ninth day of the month at even, from even unto even shall you celebrate your Sabbath. Y'all get it? So if he just told us the 10th day is the day of atonement, right? But four verses down, he say you start the atonement on the ninth day at even. That means Friday night, even when it get dark, that's the start of the 10th day. See how simple that is? So that means when it get dark, the next day is starting. You can also go to Nehemiah when he told them to close the gates of the city because the Sabbath was on its way and it was yet dark. So it was getting dark and he said the Sabbath is on its way. Why? Because when it's dark, the Sabbath day has started, meaning a day has started. Whew, Israel so smart now, man. They just then got retarded. So yeah, man. And the brother that sent me the video of the brothers who was teaching that we don't have to keep the atonement because of Romans chapter 5. That's my I could say his name. You know, Malakia Allah, good looking out. And the brother said he posed a question to them. And he posted, he sent them Acts chapter 27 and verse 9. When y'all get a chance, read that. And in Acts chapter 27 verse 9, Paul actually states out his mouth that he just got through keeping the atonement. So he asked them, what atonement was this Paul was keeping? And he said that was 5 years ago and they still ain't got back at him. They said they're going to have to look into it. But they still teaching this morning that you don't have to keep the atonement. You know what I'm saying? I ain't even get into it and really check it out that deep, but that's something y'all might want to go check out. But I ain't going to speak too much on it because I ain't really checked it out. You know what I'm saying? I just know you got to keep the atonement because you can see it throughout all them laws. They still keeping them in the New Testament. So look, right? Let's go to Isaiah chapter 58, right? So if these brothers is telling y'all, and again, this is not me trying to kick nothing off with them. That's why I ain't named their camp. But I'm just saying, they brothers got to be edified because that's dangerous, man. Like Nineveh. Like, you could get destroyed telling somebody that. So let's look at Isaiah chapter 58, right? And if they telling you don't fast on the day that the Lord commanded us to do a national fast, which is the Day of Atonement, which is tonight, from even to tomorrow evening to tomorrow night, what are you fasting for on any other day? So you mean to tell me you're not going to fast when the Lord commanded us to fast to get some of these curses up off us You know what I'm saying? As a whole, as we not even just fasting for ourselves during this day. We fasting for everybody. You know what I'm saying? For the nation. We need it. Look how we getting hit with them hurricanes. If y'all notice, them ain't been all Gentiles getting swept away. You know what I'm saying? That's been Israel too. And you look at Isaiah chapter 58. This dealing with fasting, but let's see what else is dealing with. Because we go here for the Sabbath day. But let's take a close look at this though. Isaiah chapter 58, right? Pick it up in verse 13. This is what it read. It say, if thou turn away thy foot from the Sabbath, from doing thy pleasure on my holy day, and call the Sabbath a delight, the holy of the Lord, honorable, and shall honor him, not doing thy own ways, nor finding thy own pleasure, nor speaking thy own words. So, for everybody trying to say that the Sabbath day ain't that important, it's definitely important. He went as the father say, you shouldn't be doing your own thing on the Sabbath. You shouldn't be trying to hit the club on the Sabbath, you know, get your own pleasure in. You know what I mean? You ain't supposed to be doing none of that on the Sabbath. But let's see what else is connected to this Isaiah 58. Because we see a weekly Sabbath foot thing echoing in here. But let's just read it all. I'm going to bag up to the beginning of the chapter. But peep what all he said, call our Sabbath a delight. We supposed to call the Sabbath a delight. Like it's about to be dark in about 30 minutes, I guess. We got a double Sabbath, y'all. Y'all should really praise the Most High that we alive and able to keep his high feast day. You know what I'm saying? When our father, forefathers was getting invaded in Rome, I mean by the Romans, I know they thought it was just the end of the world. They ain't know that their offspring was going to be able to recuperate and return back to the Most High. So I am gracious. I'm alive. I'm keeping his weekly Sabbath. And tonight is a double Sabbath. So I'm keeping the atonement and I'm finna atone. And like I said, the way I fast, I ain't putting nothing in my mouth. If y'all just want to make sure y'all don't eat and drink, that's cool too, according to the book. My whole thing is recognize and observe this. The Lord see you observing this. This mean a whole lot to our God. And it do us a whole lot better. Because he will reward you in public. And this is true. So we see what he said concerning them Sabbaths. You shouldn't be crying about it. You shouldn't even be, you know, talking about basketball games and all that on the Sabbath. You're supposed to be concerned with the Lord. You know, that's like reading scriptures, studying to show yourself approved, getting you some rest. Don't do no labor. You know, praying, meditating. Probably, you know, even fast. Some people fast on the Sabbath. Mikael did say, you must fast on the Sabbath. Let me throw that out there. I don't want nobody calling elders on that either. It's people that do that, though, and they are quite fine with it. I personally trying to get myself there, too. It's just discipline, man. I think it just teach us discipline. So let's back up and look at verse 1. And let's see. It say, cry loud, spare not. Lift up thy voice like a trumpet and show my people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. Sound like what we going to do during this day of atonement, don't it, y'all? Because we ain't just atoning for ourselves. We saying, man, look, God, we all done messed up, man. Israel is jacked up. We sorry, man. We done just blew a mission. We the worst priests. I know you didn't hide it. You know, we just make you look bad. You know what I'm saying? And we repent and please show mercy on us. All right, verse 2. Yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways as a nation that did righteousness and forsake not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinances of justice. You hear that? Yeah, we always ask them for justice. You know what I'm saying? But look, they take delight in approaching to God. Good. Now listen here. Wherefore have we fasted, say they, and thou seest not? So we like, man, we fasting, you don't see it? Here you go. Wherefore have we afflicted our soul, and thou takest no knowledge? Behold, in the day of your fast, ye find pleasure and exalt all your labors. Behold, ye fast for strife and debate and to smite with the fist of wickedness. Ye shall not fast as ye do this day to make your voice to be heard on high. That's key. So he talking about even when Israel would fast, we supposed to be fasting to get closer with the Most High. We supposed to be fasting when he even commanded us to fast. But you had Israelites fasting just to be sane. Like say, ooh, I'm fasting. Look how holy I am. You know what I'm saying? God like, man, dude. And Jesus going to reiterate that in the New Testament. See, this thing is all connected. Israel was doing it then they was doing it again later, and you got them doing it now. I saint them, even though they don't know they Israel. They be in the churches talking about, ooh, I'm on a fast. Face all cruddy, ain't washed it or nothing. Got cotton mouth, all of they just want to make themselves look sunk in, like they just got out of concentration camp. You know what I'm saying? And been getting tortured. Cause they want you to think, they want you to see their affliction physically. That's supposed to be between you and God, man. You know what I'm saying? So it say, okay, let me continue reading. It say, is it such a fast that I have chosen? A day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Would thou call this a fast, an acceptable day of the Lord? Is it not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke. Y'all see how important fasting is? Fasting literally is a way to cleanse yourself. In the New Testament, it tells you when somebody is possessed with an unclean spirit, sometimes the only way you can get rid of it, you want to call it demonic possession or whatever, the only way you can get rid of it is by fasting and prayer. Now y'all see the connection? It's the same thing it's saying in Isaiah. It's telling you even to get these innumerable amount of curses up off you. You know what I'm saying? You need to fast. Basically, this is, man, so the Lord will take it easy on you and hear you and ride with you and be by your side when he see you ain't fasting for people. To say, oh, look at me, I'm holy. You fasting because you want to get to know him. You want to get right by him. And you want to get back on track with the Most High. This is what it's all about. So don't let no brothers tell you don't keep the Day of Atonement, because a one verse they read by Paul, who Peter already warned you, his writings is getting people, getting people on that list. Yeah, it ain't Paul's fault, but they reading, and I'm telling you, man, it's sad. It's real scary. So let's go and see if this bag up Isaiah chapter 58 on how we fast, why we fast. And you heard about that day, appointed time of fasting, right? Like we got tonight. And it also represents when we going to go into the kingdom. You see what I'm saying? Because that land was promised to our father Jacob and his inhabitants. All this is connected, y'all. Like all of it is connected. So let's go to Matthew chapter 9 real quick. I got a couple more spots. Hopefully my phone survived. I'm surprised it went this long. And Matthew chapter 9, and I'm going to go around verse 14. No, wrong one. Mark. Yeah, Matthew 9 and 14, y'all. Okay, here you go. It say, then came to him the disciples of John saying, why do we and the Pharisees fast often, but thy disciples fast not? Now, this is a key thing. I'm reading this for a reason, too, y'all. For them brothers who telling y'all don't keep the atonement, and we just think the importance of fasting, and not only fasting, but keeping them set atonements. That's in Leviticus chapter 23, how our salvation is at stake. If you notice right here, the Pharisees came and Jesus asked him, why the disciples don't fast like they did? They fast all the time. They didn't understand who was amongst them. It wasn't that the disciples was not in a spiritual mind and didn't fast. They knew who was with them. So what are they going to fast for? They like the whole cat that we was waiting on to get sent is chilling with us right now. You know what I'm saying? So watch this. He going to read it to you, though. Let's go to Mark chapter 2. I'm going to get a second witness to this. So we're going to go to Mark chapter 2. When y'all get a chance, y'all can read that Matthew all the way on y'all own from where we just started at, because it make it clear. I'm just trying to get through this real quick. So y'all read that, because I've been talking for a while. So Mark chapter 2, y'all. And this is what it say. And I'm almost done. Mark chapter 2. And Okay, here we go. Verse 18. We keep it real quick. Verse 18. I just need a witness to that. And yeah, y'all, if y'all see them brothers, y'all know who I'm talking about. Just run this down. It say, verse 18, and the disciple, mine started 17. It say, when Jesus heard it, he said unto them, they that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. This when they was questioning Jesus, and they was like, man, why you hanging around with them scallywags? You know what I'm saying? Dude, now, man, they bogus. They trifling and ratchet. And he was like, look, y'all know the law. Y'all keeping it right. What I need to hang around y'all for? And that made me think of Facebook sometime, that I'm trying to expand my friends of people that don't really know the truth, but they searching. Because when you just got a bunch of Israelites on your page that all think they know everything, what is we accomplishing? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, everybody, other than sharing and sharpening iron, which is cool, it's a lot of Israelites that, you know, they hear the same stuff over and over. So it's like, we got to go out there and bring this to the fish. You know, we got to catch some new fish. So verse 18, it say, and the disciples of John and of the Pharisees used to fast, and they come and say unto him, why do the disciples of John and of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples fast not? So he was like, John the Baptist, his disciples used to fast often. The Pharisees fast all the time. So he asking Jesus, he like, man, why your guys ain't fasting like that? And listen to this answer, boy. He was the king of clapbacks, Joe. Watch this. Verse 19. And Jesus said unto them, can the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then shall they fast in those days. No man also soweth a piece of new cloth on the old garment, else the new piece filled up and taketh away the old, and rent his clothes is worse. So, what he just told them, he was like, look, why they gonna fast and they know I'm here with them? When it was all said and done, they was trying to get in tune with my father the whole time. You know what I'm saying? When they was doing this fasting. But I'm chilling right here with you. I'm finna go up there to him in a minute because I'm about to get killed. You know what I'm saying? So y'all might as well talk to me face to face. Don't wait till I get up there. You know what I'm saying? It make a whole lot of sense. So they had no need to fast while he was right there. I tell you, man, these is brothers. These is black people. These is our people. They even talk the same way if you take out the vowel shell, the old English. You know what I'm saying? They act. You can see it, Joe. These definitely Jakes. These definitely Jakes. So, you know, I read that just to let y'all know. Oh, I got to read this, y'all. I got to read this. So we see, not only should we be keeping the atonement tonight, and I'm going to let y'all get, because I know it's going to be some nice Sabbath classes coming on tonight. We got Friday night, I believe, Al-G. I also believe Elijah, I-C-O-J, doing one at 8 o'clock Central Time. Then I know Preacher Head got one coming on at about 9:10. He got the late night one. So we're going to try to fill ourselves up tonight on this beautiful atonement. But I want to read this, y'all. Let's go to Matthew chapter 6 and see what the master teacher said about fasting, right? Matthew chapter 6, let's pick it up in verse 16. This is what it said. But when Herod heard, wrong one. My bad, that's Mark. Matthew chapter 6. It's like, Herod, what in the world? No, that Mog wasn't fasting. I don't know who he was fasting to, Satan. Let me see. All right, Matthew chapter 6:16. It say, moreover, when ye fast, be not as the hypocrites of a sad countenance, for they disfigure their faces, that they may appear unto men to fast. Verily I say unto you, they have their reward. You heard sentiments of that in Isaiah chapter 58, remember? Talking about how they just fast for certain little reasons, want to be seen and all that type of stuff. Right here, Jesus telling you, Don't fast like these hypocrites do with your continence low. You know, around here, all, oh, I'm fasting. So people could be like, oh, you're so holy. Look at him over there just fasting. He got boogers hanging out his nose. You know what I'm saying? He musty. He don't smell good. He just super holy. Nah, fam. That's your reward right there. That's what it said at the bottom. That's all you getting, because he don't even want characters like you in the kingdom. Verse 17, it say, but thou, when thou fastest, anoint thine head. Y'all heard that? And wash thy face. So when y'all fast tonight, when y'all get up in the morning to go to class, don't come to Sabbath class with cat boogers in your eye and all that type of stuff. Make sure your face is washed. Get your nice little price, olive oil, whatever, lotion, baby oil. You know, make yourself look good. Don't go in there and act like you ain't ate in 10 years. You know what I'm saying? Verse 18, that thou appear not unto men to fast, but unto the Father, which is in secret, and thy Father, which is secret, shall reward you openly. Shabbat shalom. Happy Atonement. I love y'all, Israel. Let's get it in for the Most High. And y'all stop calling them elders, telling them Mikael said. Every time I say something, I tell y'all where I read it at, so y'all can start calling them, telling them that the prophet such and such said, and it just so happened that Mikael repeated it. So if y'all want to get how I bring the word, we have fun, we deal with history and all that, please join the Walls of Jericho Facebook group. The Walls of Jericho Facebook group. I will accept you under the conditions. We don't do no name banging. If you don't say Jesus Christ, you say Yahweh Shai, Yahoshua, Yahshua. We all cool with that. You know what I'm saying? You call the Father Yah or whatever. Yahweh, we all cool with that. Jehovah, long as we all together on one accord, that is keeping the laws, statutes, and commandments of the Most High God and turning our people back to the Most High so we can get up out this captivity, man, get to the wilderness, make it, you know, to the kingdom, and we won't have to worry about police gunning us down, being found in freezers, heads chopped off, babies being molested, all this type of stuff that's happening to the chosen people of Israel. So I love y'all. Shabbat shalom. And let's go ahead and take this affliction, baby. Peace.